Good morning, all. Welcome to the our CP event on the bankruptcy law, India and Oman. This event is in association with Muscat chapter of ICA is organized this event in association with Committee of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court. Our chief guest for the day is Our chief guest for the day. My mic is on.
Yes.
For the day is H. E. Mustafa Ahmed Salman, and we also have be honored with to have the committee members from the Committee of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court, Chairman Mr. C. A. Durgesh Kabra ji, and C. A. Prakash Sharma ji from the from India. Our guest speaker for the day will be Ashish Makija ji. And let's without taking much of time to start and Puneet Parihar ji. So without taking much of time, let's start the event with the welcome note from the CA Ramanand Prabhu ji. Prabhu ji, you have can we have a welcome note from you?
Thank you, CA Ravi ji. Good morning, one and all. Namaste, Salaam Alaikum. On behalf of the Muscat chapter ICA, it gives me great pleasure to greet you all. Invitees from Central Bank of Oman, Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Commerce and Industries, Tax Authority, Indian Embassy, guests, members of the Muscat chapter, members of the overseas chapter, ICA leaders, and my fellow managing committee members for this CPE meeting on Insolvency, Bankruptcy Court, India, and Sultanate of Oman. Today, under the patronage of our Honorable Chief Guest, His Excellency Mustafa Ahmed Salman, Honorary Consular, Australian Government, Sultanate of Oman, who is adding vibrancy to our today's meeting. We, the members of the Muscat Chapter ICA, also welcome our guest of honors, CA Durgesh Kabra, Chairman IBC, Central Council Member, ICA New Delhi, CA Prakash Sharma, Vice Chairman, IBC, Central Council Member, ICA New Delhi, Speakers of the day, Mr. Ashish Makija, Managing Attorney, AMC Law Firm, New Delhi. Mr. Puneet Parihar, Senior Associate, Alalawi Law Firm, Oman. We heartily welcome all our past chairpersons of the Muscat chapter and other overseas chapter of ICAI who are present with us today. As a part of the continuous professional education, it is our responsibility for the enlightening our members on recent developments on the legal regulatory framework and the changes and challenges happening around the world and its impact on the business community and the finance professionals in the Sultanate of Oman. Bankruptcy law promulgated by the Royal Decree 53/2019 will be effective in by July 2020 in Sultanate of Oman. Our distinguished speaker, Mr. Ashish Makija and Mr. Puneet Parihar will take you all through the various aspects of IBC, its judicial perspective and ground zero as a consultant and also a business perspective and its challenges ahead. We thank His Excellency Mustafa Ahmed Salman for his gracious presence today, and he has been a strong supporter of ICA and his continuous patronage to the Muscat chapter ICA. We also thank CA Durgesh Kabra and CA Prakash Sharma and ICA leadership team for their support extended to the chapter and look forward to their continued support to the Muscat chapter ICAI. We thank College of Banking and Financial Studies, our sponsors in Oman, for their continued support to our chapter activities in Sultanate of Oman. We also thankful to all our sponsors and special thanks to our annual technology partner, Tally Solutions. Once again, welcome each one of you to this IBC Court, India and Oman, and wish you all happy learning. Stay connected with Muscat chapter and look forward to your continued cooperation, active engagement and support. Please take precautions, stay safe. Without further ado, I hand over the proceedings to CA Raviji. Thank you very much. Over to you, Raviji.
Prabhupada, I want you to further expand your thought process to the World Congress. Can you just explain the World Congress thought?
Okay.
Yeah.
We have World Congress of Accountants 2002, which is coming in November 23 to 25 in Mumbai. I request
22,
all,
sir,
all
no,
of 20, you to,
22, yeah.
22.
World Congress of Accountants 22. I request all our members and all the invitees and guests extend this invitation to all of you, and we will look forward to see you all in Mumbai. Thank you. Thank you very much. Over to you, Raviji.
Thank you, sir. Now I request C.S. Anil ji to formally introduce our chief guest, Mr. Mustafa Ahmed Salman. Mr. Sanil ji.
Yeah. H.E. Mustafa Ahmed Salman holds an advanced diploma in accounting and is a holder of international capital market qualification. He is also a registered broker with advisory license from MSM. He has over 27 years of experience in finance related activities, of which 9 years have been in government services in positions responsible for financial activities, and 18 years in Oman capital market. Besides serving as the CEO of United Securities, he is currently Honorary Counsel of Australian Government to the Sultanate of Oman, Director of Muscat Depository and Securities Registration Company, SAOC, Director of Oman Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Director of Oman United Insurance Company, and Committee Member of Oman Kuwait Investment Company. Welcome, sir, to our event.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for your introduction to me. Thank you, Mr. Prabhu.
Now we finished.
Today's commitment with you. I am here, inshallah, hearing your nice lecture. Thanks for introduction.
Now I formally welcome with Mr. Mustafa Salman with a bunch of flower. Thank you, sir. Now I request C.A. Sajeev Surendar to formally introduce Durge Kabra ji.
Thank you, Ravi ji. P.A. Durgesh Kapra ji, Chairman, Committee on IBC, ICI, Convener, Center for Audit Quality, a Member, Quality Review Board, Vice Chairman, Committee for Members in Industry and Business, ICI. More than 30 years he has been in company law, corporate structuring, management advisory, audit and assurance services. During his WARC chairmanship in 2012 and 13, received many competitive awards, including the Best Regional Council Award, Best Students Association Award, an avid speaker and an expert on law and bankruptcy code. He has addressed more than 150 seminars, forums, and conferences on company law, LLP, and IB code. With this, we welcome C.A. Durgesh Kabra ji. Over to Raviji.
Thank you, sir. We welcome you with a bunch of flowers, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. Sir, we like to hear from you, sir.
Okay, thank you. C.A. Anand Prabhuji, the chairperson of the Muscat chapter.
Ramanand
Prabhuji, the chairman of the Muscat chapter of ICI. His Excellency Mustafa Ahmed Salman ji, the chief guest of today's webinar on the insolvency and bankruptcy code in India as well as at Oman, Mr. Ravi Devara, Mr. Sanil, and all other committee members, my co-chairman Prakash Sharma ji from India, from Jaipur, and all other participants to this wonderful event organized by the Muscat chapter. Friends, let me tell you that the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016 is one of the major economic reform being brought by the Government of India. The whole objectives of IBC is to provide a market-determined, time-bound mechanism, orderly resolution of insolvency wherever possible, and orderly and easy exit wherever it is required. The purpose of enactment of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code is normally based on the following things: to consolidate and amend the law relating to reorganizations and insolvency resolution of corporate person, partnership, firms, and individuals, to fix time period for the purpose of execution of law in time-bound manner, to maximize the value of the assets of the interested persons, to promote entrepreneurship, to create availability of credit, to balance the interest of all the stakeholders, including alteration in the order of priority of payment, which is known as waterfall mechanism, to establish an Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India as a regulatory body for insolvency and bankruptcy law. Friends, as we all know, this is a new code which is being brought in India since 2016. And since its implementation over the last 4 years, it has witnessed significant growth in terms of its utilization in the debt resolution space in the country. Creditors and debtors both have opted for the resolution process as provided under the code. Code, as we know, is evolving at a rapid pace in the country to enhance the efficiency of the processes prescribed for the effective functioning. The code has been amended 5 times since its enactment. And we see that probably there can be separate set of rules and regulation for the purpose of MSME sector, as is pronounced by Nirmala Sitaraman ji, the finance minister of the country, during the budget speech. We have already seen several stressed companies getting successfully resolved under the IBC as per the Economic Survey 2021. Since the inception of the code in December 2016, 4,117 applications have been admitted as on December 31st, 2020. The code has rescued 308 corporate debtors as on December 2020 through the resolution plan. They owed rupees 4.99 lakh crore to the creditors. However, the realizable value of the assets available with them when they entered the corporate insolvency resolution was only 1.03 lakh crore. Under the code, the creditors recovered 1.99 lakh crore, which is more than 193% of the realizable value of the corporate debtors. The recovery for the financial creditors as compared to their claims was found to be more than 43% for all the years since the inception. So that's how the IBC code has helped the country to resolve the various debt-ridden companies in India. The government proposal, which are expected to be rolled out soon in the insolvency regime in the country, are PREPEX, Special Insolvency Framework for MSME, Cross-Border Insolvency Framework, and Group Insolvency Framework. I think we have with us today two subject experts. One is Mr. Ashish Makhija from Delhi, and the another one is Mr. Parihar. And I'm sure Ashish Makhija, I have heard him many times, so I know that he is going to deal with the Indian IBC, and you will get a lot of insight and information from him. Likewise, Mr. Parihar, he'll be dealing with the Oman insolvency process. So I'm sure that today, whoever has joined this particular webinar will all get benefit, and how the resolution for the purpose of the companies or corporates which are debt ridden can be resolved easily with the help of these resolution process which are there in the IBC code and the code or insolvency resolution law in the Oman. As we know, the Council of ICAI functioning through its standing and non-standing committee, and at the ICAI, we have this particular committee which is known as Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. And there we are trying to give the maximum insight about this. We are spreading the awareness about this code across the country and internationally also to make and build their capacity in the insolvency resolution stream, because that is the area where that is going to be a lot of development in the time to come. And this one can make career into this particular area. And I'm sure, friends, the ICAI is also having its IP agency, which is known as Indian Institute of Insolvency Professional of ICAI. And we are going to work in association with IIIPI, IBBI, and our committee. And let me assure you, from our side, from the ICAI side, to the Muscat chapter, that whatever kind of help you need from the ICAI is always behind you. Don't worry at all. And I'm sure that all the possible support will be extended to the Muscat chapter. With this, I thank Ravi Devaraji, who has called me and given us the opportunity to have this program with the Muscat chapter. It's really wonderful. It was, and let me tell you, this Insolvency and Bankruptcy Committee, Ravi ji is doing the first international program. Rather, I would say we are starting with the first international webinar. So this is a great thing for us also and for you also. And I'm sure that all the participants will be benefited simultaneously. Ramanand Prabhuji, I also thank you for inviting me to the chapter. Thanks to one and all for inviting me, and we continue to support you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, it's our pleasure to be you be there with us. Now I request Jim Joseph to formally introduce our next guest of honor, Prakash Sarmaji. Jim.
Thank you, Raviji. CA Prakash Sharmaji is a Central Council member of ICAI. He's Vice Chairman of the Committee on Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. He's Chairman of Banking, Financial Services and Insurance Committee. He's Deputy Convener of the Members and Student Services. He's also taking care of grievances handling and e-Sahayada Directorate. And he's a trustee of Rajasthan Chartered Accountants Foundation. The foundation is providing a hostel named Uday Hostel for economically challenged students of in CA profession. He's also a member of various organizations like 40CII Rotary Club. And most notably, he's a national level badminton player also. So with these few words, let me welcome CA Prakash Sharmaji to our virtual gathering. On behalf of all of us, please accept this virtual bouquet, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Respected Mustafa, sir, today's chief guest, chairman of Insolvency Committee of Institute, my own chairman, Durgesh Bhai, today's speakers, chairman of Muscat and his entire team, and all participants. I welcome you all in this morning session. And thankful to Muscat chapter for providing us this opportunity. Friends, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 16, since its implementation, has offered a much awaited successful structure for the corporate insolvency resolution process in the country. A formal process of insolvency has been laid down in an explanatory manner in a short span of time, and the country has already started to witness the results of the implementation of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. If more and more corporates are being admitted into the resolution process, the code is also you're having to take care of the emerging implementation issues. We all know that the implementation of any system does not depend on the law, but also on the institutions involved in administration and execution of the same. The effective functioning and execution of all the pillars involved in the process of insolvency and bankruptcy alone with the cases admitted tells about a successful story of the journey of this new insolvency and bankruptcy code in the country. Let me tell you, friends, after implementation of this act in this country, our country jumped 14 numbers in ease of doing business in the world. So you can understand how effectively this code has been implemented in our country. And due to pandemic, it has been stopped till now to start taking cases of individual and partnership firms. After this little bit, we'll come out from this problem. We will take care of individual as well as partnership firm matters also. So I feel that the future of this act is very, very important. And we should realize one thing, that our profession is shifting from traditional practice to new areas. And I think this insolvency profession is going to be a big, big source of income and revenue for us in times to come. Looking at the importance of the knowledge dissemination on the latest developments and practical aspects of the code, the Committee of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of the Institute of Chartered Accountants India has been undertaking various activities and initiatives towards the benefits of members and stakeholders at large. This year also, we are drawing elaborate plans to work in this area. Sir, we have just recently started, because our president has officially, although he had taken oath on the 12th of February, but just a few days back, he came first time in Delhi and has assumed the charge. So we all have started working fully now in the institute. And we can assure you, on behalf of my chairman and my secretary and all our team in the institute, whatever, in whatever manner you will require any help from us, we'll be there to help you out in any matter. You are always most welcome. So I will not take much of the time, because lots of the delegates are over there and speakers are waiting for listening to their speech. So I'm the best of luck to all of you. And I hope this program will be very successful to all of you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Sir, now I request to take one group photo, because to be so let's have the memories in a bit there. Sajiji, can you do the honor of taking the photo? Nalini ji, can you switch on your video? And Yaspal ji, we have honor to have our past chairman Yaspal Mehta ji with us. Yaspal Mehta ji. Yeah. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us and supporting us in all our activity. Nalini ji also. Okay, so Sanil ji, can you take the photo? Or anybody? Done. Jim has taken, I think.
Yeah, done.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
Okay, now we are, now let's start the event further, because everybody is waiting for Asif Makija ji to come in. So let's, without taking much of time, now I request Jim is done. So myself to introduce, it's great honor to introduce Asif Makija ji. And I really appreciate the efforts of Asif Makija ji. Asif Makija ji is also chartered accountant. And he's a leading practitioner in insolvency and corporate law as a managing attorney of the AMC law firm. Academically, he's brilliant, and he is awarded with the gold medal by CBSC for obtaining 100% marks in mathematics. He has been rank holder throughout and always secured rank in FCA, Chartered Accountancy, and in even in Cost Accountancy. In masters, he has also done a master's in law from India, and as well as master's of law degree in international bankruptcy from USA. He is also an insolvency professional. He is pursued PhD in law from Embryo School of Law, Atlanta, USA. He has also had distinction of being world rank World Bank trained corporate trainer. Ashish Makhija ji has written 14 books of on the subject of insolvency and bankruptcy and corporate law. Ashish Makhija ji has a wide contributor to articles in journals, online portals, and review of repute, including CA General and the legal documents as well. He also has significant corporate board experience, and he has served as an independent director in Shipping Corporation of India, Caterpillar India Limited, and other public and private limited companies. He is keen, apart from all these efforts, he also get time for to keen golfer, and he has won coveted hole-in-one trophy in Kutub Golf Course, New Delhi. He likes to travel and explore new places. With this, I welcome Ashish Makhija ji with a bunch of flowers. Ashish Makhija ji, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ravi ji. And I, first of all, I'm so delighted that Muscat chapter has organized this kind of program. And it is always a pleasure because I must say, because I've been very closely associated with the ICAI's IPA, which is the Insolvency Professional Agency. I think they have been at the forefront, and they will be in the forefront if there is a support from their parent institute, which is ICAI. And yes, I can say with surety that ICAI has supported IPI in a very, very big manner. And we must thank ICAI plus all their council members, particularly the chairperson of the IBC committee, and Mr. Prakash also, who is the co-chairperson. I think they are doing a fantastic job. We must appreciate whatever efforts they are doing. They are doing it for the benefit of the chartered accountants. And I'm also glad to see His Excellency Mustafa Ahmed Salman ji here. We are so delighted to have you here, sir. I think like India, which has learnt its insolvency and bankruptcy from, say, a lot of developed countries like US, UK, Singapore, Australia. Well, I think Indian experience will also be useful for Oman, because Oman has also come out with the insolvency law, I have just heard. But I think we always gain from the experience of other countries. I think that's very important for us to know. Friends, my presentation is very short. It will be divided into two parts. One, I'm going to introduce the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of India to you, just giving you helicopter view. I mean, bullet points. I can't go in details, because if you want me to go in details, it'll take around 6 hours for me to explain. And number two, I will also focus on what professionals like you, chartered accountants, can do in IBC. As I think Mr. Prakash Sharma mentioned, that it offers a huge opportunity. And I think I agree with him. The reason being, I have been the standing counsel for Government of India and supporting official liquidator when IBC was not there, because the companies were being wound up under Companies Act. So I was the standing counsel in Delhi High Court for almost 7 years, and I have handled around 300 matters of insolvency and liquidation. Well, that experience has really helped me, and I was always wondering that when India will have laws like USA, where insolvency and bankruptcy is not treated as a criminal activity. And I must share this with you. In countries like us, particularly in India, the law was that if a person is not able to pay his debts, then he was considered as a criminal. And the court said, send him to jail because he is not able to pay his debts. Well, that thinking has now changed. It has taken a U-turn now. In fact, now the thinking under IBC is that the person who is not able to pay debts, including a corporate person now, they need support. Because the insolvency reasons could be financial failure, it could be business failure, or it could be fraudulent transaction. So our bankruptcy code, which is based on insolvency, which is based on Bankruptcy Law Reforms Committee report. In fact, one committee was formed under the chairpersonship and then they submitted their report. Once they submitted their report, on that basis, a bill was drafted, and it was introduced in 2015, and it became an act in 2016. So that is the short history of it. And let me share one presentation with you. I think I can share that screen. But before I do that, in fact, I have already thanked the members of the Muscat chapter. I must do that. That's my, I'm really honored to be amongst you, friends. I just want to know from Mr. Ravi Devra or Mr. Prabhu that how long can I speak? Because I must stick to the time which is allotted to me.
Sir, we actually plan our day for the up till 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock. But even if you take more than one hour and 30 minutes, is okay with us because Mr. Vinay will be speaking around 25 minutes.
Okay.
We can extend our timing to the maybe 12:30. Like we can extend.
Okay. Thank you. Anyway, I just wanted to know that because I read in the biodata of Mr. Prakash Kumar that he's also a Rotarian. I'm also a Rotarian. Mm-hmm. Well, in our Rotary Club, what happens is the meetings start at sharp at a particular time and they end at particular time. So our meetings used to start at 6:30. And from 6:30 to 7, we were meeting on a fellowship over a cup of tea or a coffee. And 7 o'clock sharp, our meeting starts. And then with 10 minutes, the president makes an announcement for blood donation, pulse polio, whatever Rotary is doing. And then a speaker is invited to speak for exactly 20 minutes, 7:10 to 7:30. So one day there were a lot of announcements and the president continued up to 7:20. So the speaker, when he rose to speak, he got only 10 minutes. So that speaker took a permission from the president. He said, sir, can you tell me how long can I speak? As I also asked him now. So our president very coolly replied. He said, sir, you can speak as long as you want, but our members will leave at 7:30. So I thought I must seek that permission so that no one should be leaving.
So nobody will leave you, sir. Even you speak a little late, now, sir. Our team is like this. Our Muscat chapter, people are very insightful and they will learn from you, sir.
No. I appreciate that you were very generous in giving me 1 hour, but I'll try to do as much as possible. I'll not hold the members. So that's the thing. Friends, this is, I think you can see my presentation also, very short presentation, which I made for you. Well, friends, I mentioned that there was winding up of companies under the Companies Act 2013. And prior to that, we had Companies Act of 1956. So if any company is not able to pay its debt, so what was the clause under Companies Act? Companies Act said, if a company is unable to pay its debts, then a creditor to whom the money is owed, and at that time, the money was around 100,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees, then anyone can go to High Court and seek for the winding up of the company. There was nothing a middle route. So therefore, if the company is not able to pay its debts, even for 1 lakh rupees, anyone can go to the court and ask for the winding up of the company. Well, this was not a good idea. So therefore, the government brought in Sikh Industrial Special Provisions Act, which is known as SICA. Very fondly, we call it as Sikh companies. Well, the definition of Sikh companies, I think most chartered accountants are aware. When the 100% net worth is eroded, then the company is known as a Sikh company. So there was a plan that before we wind up the company, why can't we make an attempt to revive and rehabilitate the company? So that was the motive of that particular act, which was brought in 1985. And what this act said, that when a company becomes a Sikh company, it must make a reference to BIFR, Board for Industrial and Financial Reconstruction, on its own. And then BFR will appoint somebody as an operating agency, which was generally the lead banker. And based on the discussions, then a plan will be approved by the BFR and then company will be revived. Because the idea is, and I think His Excellency will also agree with me, that the assets which belong to a company, well, they do not only belong to a company, they also belong to the country. Is it easier to develop, establish a steel plant in a country? Is it much easier to establish a steel electricity plant? Well, it is not. It involves a huge sum of money. Now, if that company becomes insolvent and winding up liquidation has to be started, well, that is the loss of the country and not only of that company alone. So the idea is we must try to revive and rehabilitate the company. Then, of course, in India, we had problems of non-performing assets also because the banks who have given loans, they are not able to recover. So government actually brought in two acts, which is known. One is Recovery of Debts Act and second is Securitization Act, which we call it as SARFAESI. Well, RDDB Act is that instead of going to a civil court under this act, now the banks go to a DRT, which is a tribunal. And this is a summary procedure. So they get their recovery orders fast. Second is Securitization Act, which is slightly a draconian act that without the judicial intervention, now the banks can actually take over the management of the company and also take over the property, possession of the property, which is secured with them. And then they can sell it on their own without even the judicial intervention. So that was brought in. So attempts were made so as to reduce NPA. But unfortunately, those attempts have not been very, very successful, as we have seen over a period of time. That is why, my dear friends, IBC was brought in. So what IBC brings on the table is, number one, number one is the most interesting part, which is that inability to pay debts, which was there in the Companies Act. And generally, I call it as commercial insolvency. Now, that provision has been taken out from Companies Act. So now, if a company is commercially insolvent, that is, it is not able to pay any of its amount, more than 1 lakh rupees, well, it will not go through the winding up route because that is now deleted in the Companies Act. It has to come under IBC now. And that inability to pay debts, my dear friends, now is called as default under IBC. So now we say that if a company commits a default, then its process will start under IBC. And the process is not straight away liquidation, which was under Companies Act. Now we have something in between, and that is known as insolvency resolution. So therefore, and what do you mean by insolvency resolution? Well, I would say new jumlas have come, but actually it is the same thing. Insolvency resolution means we are trying to resolve the insolvency of the company. We are trying to revive and rehabilitate the company. So it's like same. It is like SICA only, because SICA stands repealed now. But if that attempt of resolution fails, which we call it as CIRP nowadays, Corporate Insolvency Resolution Process, if that process fails for whatever reason, then the company will go into liquidation. So now an additional step has to be involved. How it is different from SICA? Number one, SICA had a very limited applicability. It was applicable, if you just read the name, it says industrial companies. It was applicable, my dear friends, only to industrial companies, that means which were into the manufacturing sector. But now IBC applies across the entire bunch of companies, be they, whether they are manufacturing companies, whether they are service industries, whether they are logistics, whether they are infotech companies, whatever companies are there. Well, all companies are covered, including private, public, everyone. So this is a big change, that first an attempt to resolve the insolvency will be made. And friends, please remember, under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of India, which we fondly called as IBC, well, friends, default is the trigger point. And what do you mean by default? I think most of the chartered accountants are fully aware. Default has to have four ingredients. Number one, there must be a debt. Number two, the debt must be due. Number three, debt must be payable. Number four, and it remains unpaid. So four elements, if they are satisfied, then a company is said to have committed default and it will trigger insolvency. Now, I'll just inform you in a little while that who can trigger it, but let's look at the other part also, which is very important. This insolvency code, as the preamble was read by Mr. Durgesh Kabra, I think if you have noticed, this act code applies not only to the corporate insolvency or limited liability partnerships, but it also applies to partnership firms and individuals and proprietorship firms. So it's a consolidation. That is why some people do ask me why it has been called as Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code and not as Insolvency and Bankruptcy Act. Well, friends, being passed by Parliament, it is an act, it is a statute, it is a law. But it has been nomenclatured as code. And code here means consolidation or codification. That means it is consolidation of insolvency laws in the country into one law, because it was scattered all throughout. For companies, it was there in Companies Act. For limited liability partnerships, it was in LLP Act. Similarly, Partnership Act also dealt with dissolution and other things of this thing. And then for individuals also, there were two different laws. Now IBC offers consolidation. These were the two laws which are still prevailing in India. That must be news to you, but they are still prevailing because more or less the provisions of Part 3 of IBC, which deals with insolvency, individual insolvency, have not been notified in full form. They have been notified, but in a very part manner. So we had these two acts in India, Presidency Towns Insolvency Act of 1909, and we also had Provincial Insolvency Act of 1920 in India. Why two acts? Well, when Britishers came to India, they established four presidency towns, which were there, right? Three presidency towns rather, Kolkata, Calcutta, Bombay, and Madras. So for these residents, there was a separate act. And for rest of India, we had provincial insolvency. But if you read both the laws, they are more or less similar. So if an individual is unable to pay its debts, they were falling under these two acts. But these two acts were very dangerous acts. Here the judge had the power that if a person is not able to pay his debts, that means he has committed an act of insolvency, he could be put behind bars. He could be sent to jail. Now, under IBC, that protection is there, that a person needs support, he doesn't need to be put into a jail. So that's a change in the mindset, I would say, the change in the thought process which has happened. Similarly, we had Partnership Act 1932, which also deals with the insolvency, similar manner in which individuals are done. So this is a very short background and genesis of IBC, friends. Let me take you to a very interesting part. Of course, these significant dates are not important. Preamble already has been read, but I will just want to focus on one aspect. Idea is that number one, we want to consolidate. What we want to consolidate? The provisions or laws relating to the insolvency resolution and reorganization of corporate persons. That means companies, including LLPs. Then it says partnership firms and individuals. And look at the next sentence, friends. This is the most crucial thing, in a time-bound manner. Time is the crucial aspect. And then if you it is done in a time-bound manner, it will result in maximization of value of it. Let me give you a very small example. When I was a standing counsel for the official liquidator in Delhi High Court, I moved an application for dissolution of the company. Dissolution is the last step of winding up. Winding up starts with a winding up order. And when the liquidator sells all the assets, gives all and distributes all money to the claimants, the last step is to dissolve the company. That means the name of the company struck off. So we moved the application in 2011. I moved that application before the judge. And the judge looked at me and he said, Mr. Makhija, congratulations. I said, my lords, thank you. Because if judge says congratulations, I have to say thank you, my lords. When I said this, then I noticed, and in fact, the judge very surprisingly noticed, he said, Mr. Makhija, this winding up order for this company was passed in the year 1971. And now you are moving an application for dissolution of the company after 40 years in 2011. So he said, congratulations, because now India's rank will go up in the world, in the World Bank ranking. Well, friends, this was the state of affairs. I'm not saying every case was pending for 40 years, but it was taking pretty long. 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, the cases were pending in courts and the companies were not being wound up. Do you think, supposing if a company which has got, say, 100 computers as its assets, supposing it comes under liquidation and you don't sell those assets for 40 years, what value you are going to get for those assets? Tell me. Not only computers, any machinery, any land, building, whatever. Land, of course, may increase, but what about building? So therefore, idea is, let us do it in a time-bound manner so that we can maximize the value. This is the main purpose. And if you read IBC, friends, you will notice that at every step, they are written the time. This must be done within 7 days, 20 days, 14 days. Even the orders to be passed by the judges are within 14 days you have to pass. So everywhere, the time limit has been prescribed. And interestingly, I must share with you, last week, I had a matter before the Honorable Supreme Court of India, and I was appearing before Justice Chandrachud. And one of the matter came where it is a very interesting history. The company's plan was approved because once this CIRP is successful, there is a resolution plan which is approved. So it was approved by the NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal. That was done in May 2019. The resolution applicant, the promoter who came in, he had to bring in money within next 3 months. He had to bring in around 50 crore of rupees, but that money was not brought in. So the erstwhile committee of creditors, that means the financial creditors like Edelweiss and other people, bankers, they actually had their own meeting and they said, this man has failed. He has not brought in the money. Let's go back to NCLT and ask for liquidation of the company because the plan has failed now. So they went back and adjudicating authority, which is NCLT, passed an order of liquidation in January 2020. Now they obviously, the resolution applicant, because he had already deposited 5 crores of rupees, so he never wanted that to be forfeited. Naturally, he filed an appeal before the appellate tribunal. And appellate tribunal again gave him chances for 3 to 4 months that you bring your money, show us the color of money. He could not bring the money. And when I argued the matter, and the court has written in a very interesting manner that liquidation should be preferred over repeated insolvency resolutions. He said, we have given few chances, but we can't give it more. So they also upheld the order of liquidation of the NCLT. naturally, now they went to Supreme Court. When they went to Supreme Court in the first hearing, one of the senior counsels appeared. He said, my lord, my client undertakes to bring the money. So judge said, okay, your client should bring in 15 crores within 1 week and rest of the 25 crore in 3 months time. So they brought in 15 crores in this, but the judge made it very clear that if you are unable to bring balance 25 crore in 3 months, you have this 5 crore plus 15 crore, which you are now depositing will be forfeited. They said, no, no, my lords, we'll do that. Anyhow, so the time was up to 25th February 2021. So the matter was heard on 1st March. The first question the honorable judge asked the person is, they said, Mr. Counsel, tell me whether your client has brought in the rest of the 25 crores or not. He said, no, no, my lord, there is this problem, there is this problem. He started quoting those problems. Then judge asked me, he said, Mr. Mukhija, what is your opinion? I said, my lords, A, we have not seen the color of money. B, this party is not a good party in the sense that they have also defaulted for 750 crores to Union Bank in Hong Kong, the Hong Kong branch of so-and-so. So they are not scrupulous people. They are unscrupulous people. So therefore, this should be rejected. And now the liquidation order should be upheld. And believe you me, yesterday we got an order where judge has written two very important things. One, he says that time is the essence of IBC. It is the important facet. And the plan which is submitted must be submitted in good faith. And if somebody submits it in bad faith, we have to take, you see, very strong action. They said, we are now upholding the order of liquidation and the money 20 crore which he has deposited will be forfeited and the liquidator should take over now. So this is the state of affairs. So what I'm trying to emphasize by just saying this is time-bound manner has become extremely important in IBC. Now, this is the report on the basis of which IBC has been introduced. This is a fantastic report, friends. This report, this committee was formed on 22nd August 2014 under the chairmanship of Dr. T.K. Vishwanathan. And friends, I must tell you, if you want to know about IBC in India, or generally speaking, I mean, not only in India, maybe anywhere in the world, please go through this report. This is a fantastic report written in a very simple language, complete clarity of thought. I have read so many reports on corporate governance, ranging from Cadbury's report, from King's report, Ney's report, and Indian three, four Indian committees reports also. But this is the report is one of the best reports I've ever read. So please lay your hands on it and you will really, really fall in love with this particular report. And another reason which I can give you is for reading it and the ladies who are here, probably they will be very happy to know about it. And the reason is that in the entire report, Dr. T.K. Vishwanathan has used the word she instead of he, because generally in laws, you will find he, him, and his, but he has used the word she, her, and the other words which he has used relating to. So that's again a change of mindset. So I think we can also read it just for this purpose also. The report came in November 2015, but what was the rationale? Look at this, I'm just giving you small bullet points here. Identification of the difficulties in the earlier regime, that what were the difficulties which we are facing? Number one, multiple forums were there. For companies winding up, you had to go to Companies Act. Then for under CICA, you had to go to DRT. Similarly, for individual insolvency, you had to go to civil court. So there were a lot of forums were there. So they said, look, we should have only single forum, which is now known as adjudicating authority, which means National Company Law Tribunal, NCLT. Then they said requirement of a unified law. Bankruptcy is an important subject. So why can't we bring together and make a law as a unified one, whether be it is corporate insolvency, personal insolvency, partnership insolvency, and so on and so forth. Then they said, okay, having decided that, now let's decide a very important question. What is to be done when a default occurs? Should we go for liquidation or should we start the insolvency resolution process? So they said, let us try to do insolvency resolution process. And this is written in the report. If resolution fails, only then it will be liquidation or bankruptcy. Very important word which they have written is speed is the essence. And this is reflected in the preamble, time-bound manner. And this is also reflected in Supreme Court judgments now, which has quoted, and I can share that judgment with you, time is the important facet in the court. I mean, we are seeing the jurisprudence being changed over a period of time, but this is something extremely important. Then it say, I wish you to identify and address the sources of delay, because delays were happening. I told you just now, 40 years it took the official liquidator to wind up a company. Well, if exit route takes so much of time, which company or which investor, foreign investor, is going to come and invest in your country? If you give them the idea of exiting quickly, well, everyone will be interested in, you see, putting up their industry or putting up their money, isn't it? So that's the idea. And then need for a regulator. Obviously, if there are professionals who are working like insolvency profession, now that is, I'm going to come to the, which will probably interest a lot of chartered accountants here also. Insolvency professional, you can become an insolvency professional. I'm also an IP. I'm also an insolvency. Of course, I am not practicing as an IP, but I'm a registered IP. So therefore you need a regulator. So regulator is known as Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. They are regulating three people. Number one, IPs. Number two, IPAs, insolvency professional agencies. Number three, there is one more new authority which is being constituted, which is known as information utility. That will also be regulated by IBBI. And then friends, cross-border insolvency provisions are very, very important. Today, the world is one, isn't it? Insofar as business is concerned. Now, Tatas have bought Jaguars outside in UK. Similarly, foreign companies also come and own a part of companies in India or maybe other parts. Even in Oman also, a lot of foreign companies would be there. Don't you think cross-border insolvency becomes important? I'll give you one small example. Jet Airways in India came into insolvency. One of the aircraft of Jet Airways was parked in Schiphol Airport in Netherlands. Well, all the planes are on lease. So lease rentals were not being paid because the company was in financial difficulty. So the lessor of that plane approached the Netherlands courts and said a receiver should be appointed so that this plane can be sold. And then probably this is my plane, it should be returned to me. So the Netherlands court, insolvency court, they appointed a receiver. But the company is now incorporated in India, Jet Airways. Now here in India, Jet Airways came into CIRP. So an insolvency professional was appointed. And under the code, he has to take custody of all the assets. So he wrote to Netherlands courts. They says, look, this is an asset of the Jet Airways, so it should be handed over to me. Now there is a clash between two countries. One country's court says, no, I have appointed a receiver. I will not hand over the asset to you. Or India's law says, no, it should be handed over to the insolvency professional who is appointed. Well, friends, if there is cooperation is not there between two countries, well, this cannot be resolved. So UNCITRAL, United Nations, has come out with a formula that, look, we should have provisions relating to cross-border insolvency, where there can be a cooperation between the countries. And that is what it is required. I did my LLM from US in international bankruptcy, and there I'm seeing that a lot of countries cooperate with each other. That means an order which is passed in one country should be respected in the other country. That is what this cross-border insolvency means. So cross-border insolvency also is going to be a huge, huge area of practice, friends, because world has become one small village or small global thing. I mean, it is not restricted to the boundaries now. Of course, every country has a boundary and we have to respect that. But insofar as the businesses are concerned, they are spread far and wide. These were the three reasons for insolvency, which has been mentioned in BLRC, Bankruptcy Law Reforms Committee report. And report says very clearly, Dr. Vishwanathan says, if a company fails financially, if a company fails business-wise, because like when the mobile phones came, the pager companies went out of business. So it was a business failure, which was out of control of anyone. Then the Dr. T.K. Vishwanathan says that the companies need support. But he says, if there is a fraudulent operation, then the promoters should be sent behind bars. We should not leave them. These are the three reasons which he has mentioned. Wonderfully written report. Then he says, these are the steps in insolvency. We must assess the viability, whether we can revive that company or not. If not, then of course, it should go into liquidation. The other part, friends, this is extremely important. That says conflicts in creditor-debtor negotiation. When your company fails, the company is a debtor, it owes money to the creditors. Well, they say then the creditors must, you see, cooperate between with themselves also and try to find out one formula, because there may be 10 banks who might have given loans. Well, they have to come down on a single platform and resolve that controversy. And the other thing, friends, which is also extremely unique in India, is sidestepping of promoters. When the company comes under insolvency, friends, mark my words, insolvency professional becomes the CEO of the company. He gets all the powers of the board of directors of the company. And the idea is that the promoter should sidestep. And now the committee of creditor will come into being, which will oversee during the CIRP period. And that is what it is known as. This is, you see, debtor control to a, you see, creditor control. This is for the first time which has happened under this IBC. Under SICA, even when the plan was being considered, rehabilitation plan was being considered by SICA, by the BFR, well, promoters were there in the saddle. They were running the company. But now under IBC, they have to move out for that period. So that's a very interesting concept which has now come. Well, these are the three core features. Number one, linear process. That means we should have single process of very linear process. Then collective mechanism, because all the creditors now join hands together to resolve the insolvency. And third is time-bound process. Please do not forget the word speed is the essence. That is extremely important out there. And this is one of the beautifully written pages there, chapter there. Low time to resolution, low loss and recovery, higher levels of debt financing. These are the objectives of IBC. And Dr. Vishwanathan says, very interestingly, he says performance of the code in implementation will be determined on the outcome of the above objectives. And I think the data was shared by Mr. Durgesh Kabra that how much successful, you see, Indian insolvency code has been. So what I can say is that, because he also mentioned that what is, whether we are taking long time to resolve or not, whether there is a loss, low loss in recovery or not. Well, our loss in recovery obviously will be there, but it has to be low loss. So on an average, banks are recovering around 43 to 45% of their dues. That's on an average. In some cases, it is 60%. In some cases, it may be 20%. But on an average, 40% is being recovered. And 60%, we call it as haircut. Okay. So that is a new slang in IBC, haircut. So creditors have to take haircut. This is just a very small overview. As Durgesh ji also mentioned that it has been amended 4 or 5 times. Well, every year the amendment has happened. It started with 255 sections. Now we have 263. We started with 11 schedules. Now we have 12. And one of the interesting judgments in under which of Supreme Court, where Justice Nariman has mentioned, very interestingly, well, a judge decides, but he also sometimes go into philosophical manner. So Justice Nariman in one of the judgments, particularly Swiss Ribbons Limited, which is a landmark judgment, which must be read by all, he has written an epilogue. And in epilogue, he has mentioned a very interesting word that every economy of the country has a right to experiment. They are supposed to learn from trial and error. He says Indian economy is also learning from experimentation of IBC. And can you believe that there have been large number of amendments which have taken place in IBC. And sometimes the concept have changed 180 degrees. But that is what he says. This is the dynamism. This is the proactiveness of the government, that they are actually listening to the public demands, listening to the problems of the industry, and they are changing the law in a very, very quick manner. This is just fantastic, friends. I really appreciate that. And this is, I'll just give you a small overview, friends. IBC, our code is divided into 5 parts. Very easy to understand. I'm just giving you an overview. Part number 1 is preliminary, which talks about definitions and all. Part number 2 deals with corporate insolvency, companies. That means insolvency resolution and liquidation for corporate persons. And then it is divided into various chapters, CIRP, liquidation, fast track, voluntary liquidation, and so on and so forth. Then part number 3 deals with insolvency resolution and bankruptcy for individuals. Just look at the words which are used. I'll just take you back to the previous slide, friends. Look at the heading of part 2. Insolvency resolution and liquidation. The word used is liquidation. Look at the part 3 heading. Insolvency resolution and bankruptcy. Here the word liquidation is missing. They are using the word bankruptcy. Why? The reason is simple. You can't liquidate an individual. If an individual becomes an insolvent, obviously the next stage is that he's declared as bankrupt. You can't say that you have no right to live, because company will die, but individuals cannot die. So therefore, my dear friends, please note the change in the word insolvency and bankruptcy. That is why two words are used in IBC. And again, it is divided into various processes that there could be a fresh start process, there could be insolvency process, and if the insolvency process fails, then bankruptcy will ensue. And bankruptcy means assets of that individual will be taken over by a bankruptcy trustee. He will sell those assets and pay to the creditor. So this is what a lot of similarities is there between CIRP and individual insolvency, but a lot of differences are also there. And part four deals with the regulatory. I told you IBBI is the regulator. We have IPAs, we have insolvency professionals, and we have information utilities. Well, very small thing on information utilities. You must be wondering, what is information utility? Well, friends, let's take an example. There were four banks which have given loans to the companies, bank A, B, C, D. Company is paying regularly to bank A, bank B, bank C, but it has defaulted in payment to bank D. Now, what is the collective information that bank D should know, that bank A should know that there is a default to bank D? Because bank A is very happy. They are sitting in their AC environment and AC office saying the company is very good, they have been paid, updated, regardless of the fact, not knowing that the company has defaulted to bank D. This is what has been mentioned in the report of BLRC as asymmetry of information. That symmetrical information was not available to all the bankers and the creditors. Now in India, they are now incorporating an information utility, which has now been constituted also. It has been constituted by 27 banks and LIC and other financial institutions. Now what every bank which has given a loan has to inform information utility. And the moment a company commits a default, it will also be informed to information utility. And information utility in turn will send an email to all the bankers and all the creditors that the company has defaulted. So now even a single rupee default is known to all the bankers. So there is no asymmetry, there is symmetrical information. This is the purpose of information utility. I mean, it is slightly different from CIBIL, because CIBIL is something credit rating, but this is something different. Information utility is getting all the information, and even other creditors like operational creditors can also get the information out here. And then of course, part number five talks about miscellaneous, which are rulemaking powers, which are there. So this is, friends, you see, in short, the whole process of IBC in India. Now I will just take 5 more minutes on the 5 or 10 minutes more, not taking too much of time, just to tell you what professionals can do. Friends, this Act Code offers two very great opportunities to the insolvency professionals. And I think even in Oman, I'm not sure about that law. I've not read that law, but I'm really sure that probably that opportunity exists there also. Today, you need professionals like chartered accountants, cost accountants, company secretaries, and advocates to be appointed as insolvency professionals and liquidators. Because the government should not appoint these people. I mean, there should be private people who should be doing this. So what they are trying to do now is that they are trying to train people, particularly chartered accountants. So first condition, a chartered accountant who has a membership of 10 years, no certificate of practice. That is not the rule. Even if you are in employment, you are still eligible to become an insolvency professional. So 10-year membership to the Institute of Chartered Accountants, that is required. Second, you will have to take an exam which is known as limited insolvency exam, which is a multiple choice question exam. 75 questions are asked, 60% you have to score. There is a negative marking also, but this is not a very easy exam, but it is not very tough also. And the pass percentage is around 17 to 20%. So if you pass that exam, and then you have to have 50-hour training with the IBBI, with the regulator. After doing these two things, then you are registered as an insolvency professional. And the moment a company comes into insolvency, well, any insolvency professional can be appointed. And look at the job of the insolvency professional, what he has to do. He has to A, manage the company as a going concern. I mean, that means perform all the responsibilities of the CEO and the board of directors. Two, he will also have to have compliances done. He has to give a lot of information to IBBI, the regulator. He has to deal with legal matters. He has to coordinate with the resolution applicant so that a plan comes and the company survives. So a lot of huge responsibilities are there. So skill sets which are required, my dear friends, are totally different. I mean, it's not that I'm, you see, doing my audits and tax returns, so I'm competent to do that. Well, you are definitely competent, but you will have to adopt different type of skill sets. So a lot of trainings and other things also go on. And I'm very happy. I'm very happy to be associated with a lot of organizations in India, including IBBI, as their faculty for training insolvency professionals. And I'm so happy to tell you that out of 3,500 or 4,000 IPs who are there in India, well, 1,500, more than 1,500 have been mentored by me. I mean, I'm so happy to be associated with, you see, most of them. So this is an extremely good area, friends, that you need to learn from the experience of the existing people, existing IPs, but it is offering a huge scope. A huge, huge scope, friends. Let me give you a very small example of the money part, because most of the chartered accountants are interested in how much fees I'm going to get on from these assignments, isn't it? So in liquidation, let's understand what is the liquidation fees is there. The liquidation fees is something like this. If you do a liquidation of 10 crore company, I'm talking about in Indian rupees, 10 crores of rupees. If you complete that process, my dear friends, in say 6 months, that means you sell the assets and then you distribute the money. Can you believe how much you're going to get? On first 1 crore, you get 5%. What's that? 5 lakh rupees. On the next 9 crores, you get 3.75%. How much it comes to? I think all of you are chartered accountants. Roughly, it comes around 33 lakhs. So 33 plus 5 is 38 lakhs. And that is on realization of the assets. If you distribute, you get 50% of this. That means 57 lakhs. So you get 57 lakhs if you just complete a 10 crore liquidation in just 6 months. Imagine if you get 3 assignments of these type. And imagine if you are doing 100 crore company. Imagine if you are doing liquidation of 5,000 crore company, because there are few companies which have got assets of 5,000 crore in India now. Imagine what is going to be the fees. So if you still want to do audits and file income tax returns, that's your choice. But if you want to come into this area, well, this offers a huge area. And I'm sure Oman also offers you huge opportunities to earn in this manner, isn't it? But of course, mark my words, friends, money is one part. We must perform our assignments and duties with absolutely ethical, in a very, very ethical manner. So code of ethics is also very important. And I am sure all chartered accountants are following that. We have to follow the code of the ethics, because I must tell you, on the way as an IP or as a liquidator, there will be a lot of inducements will be there. Lot of influences will also be there. Lot of threatening will also be there. And I'm sure you must have read in the newspaper that many IRPs have been arrested also, and they have been threatened also. But that's a part of the job. I think that's a part of the job. So, but they are only exceptions. I mean, out of say 4,000 cases, if we hear news of only 10 cases, well, that's a part of the job, isn't it? Even if you are doing investigation audit, well, you will still getting threats, isn't it? You somebody may try to influence you. That's a part of our job. So I think if we do that in a ethical manner, friends, it is going to be an excellent. Well, now last word. If Muscat chapter wants my support in training the people who are interested in becoming insolvency professional, yes, Mr. Prabhu, Mr. Ravi, I offer my services. So you can bank upon
me. We will do this. Yeah.
Please do that, sir. I think, and one more aspect, sometimes people come and ask me, why should I do it? I tell them, I said, why not to do it? You may not practice as an IP, but what is the harm if your business card says insolvency professional? It gives you credibility, friends. And once you do that, it will actually change your whole vision. You will not be only in your office, but you will be thinking very broadly about industry. You will be thinking about countries. You will be thinking about cross-border insolvency. And particularly youngsters, I can tell you, friends, for youngsters, this is a very, very good area. Okay, one more news for the youngsters. Those who have not attained the age of 28 years, young chartered accountants, there is a program which has been initiated by Government of India, particularly IBBI. There are 45 seats all over India. You can join a one-year residential program. It is a residential program. It is not part-time. You have to join full-time. And after 1 year, extensive training, you will become insolvency professional and you will be equivalent to me or anybody else. And youngsters, please note, today I may be in my 50s. How long can I work now? Tell me. next 10 years, 15 years maximum, not more than that. Obviously, somebody is going to take a retirement in a particular age, isn't it? Well, if you become insolvency professional at the age of, say, assuming 30, you have got 30 to 35 years of career behind you. We will fade into the history. Our sun will set someday, but your sun is rising. So please take up this job. Please take up this profession. It's a fantastic profession, my dear friends. Thank you so much, friends. And thank you for giving me an opportunity. I hope I could justify my time. Well, if anybody has any questions, I will be able to answer it to the best of my abilities. Thank you.
We'll ask all my team members, attendees, to, if you have any questions, put in the question association or in the chat box so that we can answer, get a feedback from him. Mr. Ashish, I just want to tell you that you are so wonderful in your speech that you kept H.E. Mustafa Ahmad Sulman alive here with listening to you, and he was not able to move out of, even his busy schedule, he was with us. So now this is the great things. So
I think I must appreciate, and I think generally what I see is the chief guest which is invited generally leaves in 5-10 minutes. We must appreciate his involvement out here. Thank you so much, sir, for being here. And I think everyone appreciates this. Thank you so much.
Mr. Ashish, you have been really, really impressive on this commitment. I like clearly what you stick to time bounds and the using of word of ethical to the all chartered accountant on the job. And that is what we need, especially time bounds. We hope all the courts take that in the manner all the companies take. And of course, new subject, you differentiate it between the bankruptcy and new life of the company again, to giving new life by insolvency, which is really, really appreciated. And we hope, because we're going to see a lot of cases because of COVID now.
Right.
And that's also, if you can just give us then where these cases will come in, business model or financial issues or the third one, which I don't know how you're going to define these cases, then it should be good to understand
okay.
what COVID will affect.
Yes. I think, sir, that's an excellent question which has been put, particularly in relation to COVID. Well, what India has come out with a solution, I can just quote that first. Number one, India has identified a COVID period. So in India, the COVID period starts from the date when the lockdown was announced, that is from 25th March 2020. Initially, it was given as a 6 months period, that was, it was going up to 24 September, but then it was extended two times, three months. So now it is going up to 25th March 2021. That was the power given under the law. Well, government cannot extend it beyond that unless they amend the law. Well, here we are hearing a news from our top bank in India, like State Bank of India. They have requested the government that please extend this time, because otherwise industry will suffer. So we don't know whether it's going to be extended, but I think very actively the government of India, particularly finance minister, is considering that request. Number two, second, this is very interesting, sir. During the COVID period, which is now 1 year, any default which is committed by any company is known as COVID period default. And our law says now that during the COVID period default, any default committed, no insolvency proceedings can be started against that company. That means one formula to simply to understand, COVID period default is equal to zero default. It is not considered as a default at all. And not only during this period, sir, CRP proceedings cannot be started anytime later also for the default committed during this period. So this is the blanket benefit or protection which has been granted to micro, small, medium, and other enterprises. This is one thing which has been thought.
Mr. Rupesh Radhakrishna ji has requested one question.
Yes.
Thank you, CA Makhija ji, for the talk. Could you please brief a touch upon the professional and other liabilities of IPs?
Okay. IPS. Interesting. Very interesting, sir. Well, friends, let's not be afraid of liabilities. There are no personal liabilities as such. obviously, if you are performing as a professional, you have to perform in a because you are a custodian there. You are in a fiduciary capacity. Those assets do not belong to you. So therefore, it's a public money which you are dealing. Well, you always have the risk of somebody going filing a false complaint against you. That risk will always remain. I mean, we can't help take it. But what you need to do is, and I'm coming out with a book also on that subject now, safety net for insolvency professionals. I mean, you have to build a safety net around you so that problems are bound to come, but they should rebound. That's what the idea is. So if you are doing your things in an ethical manner, that's why I use the word code of ethics. If we are doing our work in ethical manner, nothing to be afraid of. And two, I must also share this with you, and I think Oman law must be saying this same thing. Section 233 of Indian IBC code, it says protection of IPs if the work is done in good faith. They said no prosecution, no criminal liability will attach if they work in good faith. So the bottom line, friends, is good faith.
Yes.
That's what I can say.
So we have some comments from the Kambavati members. They have appreciated your efforts, an excellent session. Can you, one Mr. Nitin Panchal has requested that, can you please arrange similar event for pre-PAX, which is VOC?
Okay. Pre-PAX is a very new concept which has been brought in, but it is already existing in some developed countries like UK. Pre-package is because those laws have been there for quite a long time. We are a very new country for that matter. But the idea was that what happens is promoters lose their control. That is what I told you, sidestepping of promoters. But the promoters say, look, if there is a financial failure or a business failure, not account of my fault, I have not done any mischief, no fraudulent transactions have been done, then why should I be told to go out of my company? So should I not be given a chance? So now they are coming out with a pre-package. That means before even the CIRP starts, there should be a pre-package. Somebody must come with a pre-package and it will offer to the promoters on certain terms. Promoters will accept it and the company will revive. That is the idea, pre-package. That means rather than bringing the company into insolvency, because there is one more statistics. We may be patting our backs on the money terms, that we have recovered so many lakhs of crores. Well, that is good. But look at the other dark side also. Friends, out of 100 companies, 75% are going into liquidation. Only 25% have been able to resolve their insolvency. So in terms of numbers, the statistics is reverse. That was not the idea of IBC. IBC was 75% should resolve and 25% should go to liquidation. But it is the other way around. That is why the government is now bringing in pre-package deals so that companies can survive on that. And Raviji, I'll just take one more moment. In fact, I was a part of a lot of committees which were formed by Ministry of Corporate Affairs in framing the rules, regulations, and many other discussions. And in fact, in pre-package also, I was also involved in some discussions. So these are very interesting things. So if you, what I can suggest to you in a Muscat chapter, please have one insolvency and bankruptcy committee in your chapter itself. Right. And then you can start working on like sessions on, say, cross-border insolvency. But then we can go very specific on a particular section also.
Sir,
and well, yeah. If you want my involvement, I'll be available.
Sir, we have a College of Banking and Financial Studies, which our main sponsor. They are in a mode of study. And they our one of the job is to provide us tuitions or teaching on the various professional subject or to our Omani friends. So we will be definitely looking at you for Oman bankruptcy law to be taught to our team members in a more detailed way. We will be sharing you the thought process on the Oman bankruptcy. You stay with us. Puneet will be guiding you the brief on it. Then you can have more learnings. We have one more question from Sandeep Kunte. Are the intentional defaults excluded from COVID period exemption? Ills people would take advantage of this facility?
Okay, good question again. Well, default is a default, my dear friends, whether it is intentional or non-intentional. So both are excluded. Well, we can always say if 100 out of 100 people, if 90 are good, 10 are going to be bad fishes. Well, they have to float in the water. Well, we can't help it. But yes, if they do badly, then they are going to do badly in later also, post-COVID period also. So they are not going to survive. Well, yes, the answer is yes. It includes both intentional as well as non-intentional. But that was not the intention of law. that much I can say. So, and I think Raviji, I can also say His Excellency Mustafa Ahmadji has been very keenly hearing it. And I've not gone through the Oman law. Of course, I have read Singapore law, UK law, US law, international bankruptcy also. Maybe wherever, I would definitely like to be involved in Oman law also, so that at least we can work together and we can see that this law is developed, you see, in a big way across all countries.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I'm taking on, not without taking much of your time. So there are a few more questions and people, few more queries from the people. So some of the very quick questions, and if you answer one yes or no, and very, very quickly,
yeah, we'll sure.
The timelines. Okay, because sure. I don't want to say that people leave the next session. So there are some detailed session on the cross-border insolvency somebody is requesting. And then we have that we will be looking forward for you to be the trainer in our Muscat chapter. And we'll look forward for the detailed training session from you. And there is 110. Does 10 section 10 application is justified to be suspension?
No. Short answer is no.
No, correct. That's it. Close. Thank you. Now I request H.E. Mustafa Ahmad Salman to formally present e-certificate on behalf of Muscat chapter to the yes. well-deserving Asis Makijaji. Sir, over to you, sir.
Yes, Mr. Ashish, I hope you accept this certificate from the Oman chapter. And you are really great. And, good luck for you and your career and in the future. Thank you
so much, sir. And I accept this certificate with all humility at my command. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Ashish. Now I request Manish Jain to, thank you, sir. You be with us, sir, for the Oman law.
Yes.
Thank you, Ravi.
Manish ji, can you introduce me, our next speaker, Vinit ji?
Sure. Ravi, I'm audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Thank you, Ravi, and good morning, friends and members. It's indeed my pleasure to introduce next speaker, Mr. Puneet Parihar. Mr. Puneet is currently working as senior associate in corporate practice. Before joining Al Alavi and Company, he has worked for AJB and Partners, the top law firm in India. Puneet has been recognized as a leading practitioner in the field of mergers and acquisitions and joint ventures in the prestigious 2017 RSE India report of law firms in India. Puneet also holds a double bachelor's degree in business administration and law, having graduated with honors in corporate law from National Law University, Jodhpur. Puneet specializes across border equity financing, merger and acquisitions, joint ventures, where he has actively led and closed the transactions. As a part of his practice, he regularly advises various government authorities on matters relating to their infrastructure projects. Puneet also represents the firm on advising various banks on variety of corporate and social assignments. With this brief introduction, I welcome Mr. Puneet to take over.
With a bunch of flowers, sir. Mr. Puneet, we welcome you with a bunch of flowers.
Yeah, I also welcome him with a bouquet of flowers.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, His Eminency Mustafa Sultan Ahmad, learned speaker Mr. Makhija, and the eminent members of the ICAI Muscat chapter. Well, I will say it is a privilege for me to be a part of this association, and definitely was quite enlightened with the guidance which was provided by Mr. Makhija over the bankruptcy law and the way it has been coded and implemented in India. It definitely gives us a lot of insight on what are the things that we need to expect and practice while we are implementing the nascently enacted bankruptcy law of Oman. So without any further ado, I'll directly take you all to the basics of the bankruptcy law of Oman, its history and its application. So the first thing is, what is bankruptcy? Now, as Mr. Makhija explained, it is basically a proceeding under the law that grants partial or complete relief from the payment of the debts of an organization. So like Mr. Makhija pointed out, initially being a bankrupt used to be a stigma on a professional or a corporate or an industrialist. But recently, with the onset of the new laws, the corporates and the industrialists have been given an option where they can come ahead and come forth and basically try to resolve the existing debts through a more amicable settlement, where the lenders can also look for a certain haircut in order to ensure that these corporates and these companies can continue to operate and provide a value to the nation. Now, with that onset, initially, if you look into the history of Oman, there were a couple of laws which used to govern the different the practice of bankruptcy. So there was the commercial law, which was promulgated by Royal Decree number 55 of 1990, and the commercial companies law, which was promulgated by the Royal Decree number 18 of 2019, which provided for the mechanism through which an entities were basically subject to bankruptcy. However, this was only an option given to either the companies under the commercial companies law or to partnerships under the commercial law. Therefore, in order to bring all the other entities in the one umbrella, the new law was promulgated and of course it was implemented. Now, what does this new law apply to? This new law, which is the bankruptcy law, it applies to traders as such defined under the commercial code. Now, what does a trader in a commercial code means? It basically means any person, be it legal or natural, who has the requisite capacity and who adopts such transaction as a business to be considered as a trader. Now, what does this include? These includes all the companies, all the entities practicing commercial activities, and it also included branches of foreign companies. Now, why was this very important? It was important because if you look into the aspect of foreign branches of Oman branches of foreign companies, there were various instances in the past where, owing to the different legislations or owing to not able to realize profits from the projects in which they had invested, they were facing a lot of problems when it comes to exiting or closing down their branches. So that is where the new law comes in, and it brings a relief to these foreign branches who for some reason have not been able to realize the profits or are running into heavy losses and they have incurred substantial debts. But one of the notable exceptions to the bankruptcy law is that the companies which are engaged in the business of banking, that is the banks, and insurance, that is the insurance companies, have been kept out of the purview of the law. Now, what does this mean? This means that normal banks, which are all or insurance companies, which are organized in the form of a SAOC or SAOG, that is a company, will have to rely upon the provisions set out in the commercial companies law rather than the bankruptcy law in case of arriving or looking for any kind of a settlement under the bankruptcy law. Now, with this, I move on to one of the most important things of this law. Like Mr. Makhija emphasized and impressed upon the point that time is a sine qua non to any kind of a bankruptcy proceeding. So that too has been taken care of with the implementation of the new law. They have given a time period of 5 years for a company or for a trader who is looking or who wants to enter into a kind of a settlement or wants to initiate a proceeding for bankruptcy under the law. So therefore, if he's able to come out of the debt, financial debt, or the organized settlement with the lenders within a period of 5 years, he will no longer be considered to be bankrupt and he can continue with his regular commercial operations. However, after at the onset of 5 years, if he's still not able to recover or come into a more financial stable stage, then definitely that will lead to the closure of the business and dissolution of the assets of that particular entity. Now, how does this restructuring under the bankruptcy law happens? Now, in this particular case also, like India and other prominent bankruptcy legislations across the world, the concept of receiver has been introduced. Now, that receiver is obviously appointed by a competent court before whom an applicant for seeking bankruptcy has approached. Now, like Mr. Makhija was mentioning about who is a receiver. Now, that question as of now has been left unanswered because the law itself seeks to have a new code in place or the new regulations in place for the purpose of determining how will the receivers will be appointed and what will be the schedule through which these bankruptcy experts will have to be appointed and how will they have to be registered as a bankruptcy expert. So therefore, we wait to hear more upon this particular law since this is in a nascent stage. Now, what are the conditions which a trader which is looking to file an application for bankruptcy needs to adhere to? Now, there are certain eligibility requirements. One of them being that the relevant debtor will have to be there in business for at least 2 years. So that means while applying for bankruptcy under the law, he will have to produce a specific certificate from the OCCI or stating that yes, it has been in existence and it has continued to be in operation for a minimum period of 2 years. The second thing is that he must produce evidence of the financial and administrative hardship which has led to such trader approaching the court seeking protection under the bankruptcy. Okay. Now, while this has been stated, but there has been no eligibility or underlying guidelines which could substantiate or which could provide more weightage as to how does a person determine whether it is a temporary or a ongoing financial administrative hardship. Therefore, we will have to rely upon the wisdom of the court and the way they have interpreted. Although Oman is a civil law practicing country, but definitely when these kind of cases do and judgments do come out, they will definitely add to a little more of interpretation in which these conditions and these eligibility points, eligibility conditions have to be determined. The last thing is that the application for seeking protection from bankruptcy has to be filed within 6 months from the occurrence of the hardship. Now, again, the point lies that when does a trader determine whether a hardship has arisen from a particular date? So therefore, this is where we will have to rely upon the expertise of a insolvency or a bankruptcy expert who will have to assist and will have to guide the trader looking for protection under the bankruptcy law to assess and provide him more guidance as to when is the opportune time for the trader to file for protection under this particular law. Now, one of the important things of this law was that it has repealed the Chapter 5 of the Commercial Code. Now, why was this important? Because to an extent, it was contradictory to the provision of the current act. While the provisions of Chapter 5 of the Commercial Code directly provided for the insolvency proceedings to have started and a receiver to be appointed to take over the assets, with the period given under the bankruptcy law, the administrative and the financial control of the company seeking protection from the bankruptcy will be extended to a period of 5 years. So that means this gives a eminent protection to the traders in this particular case. Now, the another key aspect is the preventive composition. Now, what is that? It is basically in the form of a settlement, like Mr. Makhija mentioned, in terms where the banks take a haircut. This is where the debtor will have to reach out to the creditors and will have to enter into a settlement with them. Now, this settlement will provide for a mechanism in which the entire debt, which is owed to by the debtor, will have to be either refinanced or basically the way in which it has to be rechanneled, either in a form of reduction in the total outstanding due or in the form of an increased moratorium period through which the creditor may look to the debtor may look to repay this particular loan. Now, this will be done in the form of a settlement agreement, which will have to be filed before the court, before the relevant court. And once this settlement agreement has been signed and filed, the protection under the bankruptcy starts. Okay, and then the period, whatever has been agreed between the debtor and the creditor, gets implemented. Now, during this period, one of the notable exceptions is that if the creditors believe that there was a fraud on part of the debtor, where he purposely or for some reason failed to disclose certain important facts, which could have led to which could have not led to the execution of the settlement agreement, they can still approach the court seeking annulment of such a settlement agreement. So that is why fraud is one of the exceptions, okay, to the filing of a petition for restructuring under the bankruptcy law. Now, other than this, the important point on bankruptcy is that there are various methods which have been designed for debtors to avoid bankruptcy. Okay, now how does a bankruptcy may be initiated? It can be initiated either by the debtor or by the creditors, okay? But the key requirement is that there has to be a failure by the debtor for a continuous period of 15 days from failing to pay its debt. Now, I do believe, in my personal opinion, that this period might be a little too small for a debtor and gives a creditor a large leeway in terms of exercising its right under the bankruptcy law. So maybe during the period, perhaps the law, when it starts becoming a little more mature, will try to give a little more time period to the debtors in order to give them a little more protection from being subject to any kind of a bankruptcy proceeding. Now, what happens when a bankruptcy petition has been filed? Now, once a petition for bankruptcy has been filed, the court will issue a judgment and appoint a liquidator who shall be responsible for managing and overseeing the bankruptcy process. Now, mind you, at this stage, just like the Indian process, the financial and administrative control of the company will pass on to the administrator, to the liquidator, and that is where the original debtor will lose his right over the company. Therefore, it is important for the liquidator to have the adequate responsibility, and he should be financially and administratively well versed with the management of the debtor and the kind of organization that he is expected to look after. Now, at the end of the period which has been determined by the court, the liquidator will be required to publish a summary of the bankruptcy judgment in the Official Gazette, where the creditors will be invited to provide details of any debts that are owed to them. So that is where this important point, this process becomes important, because then that is the only chance where the creditors of such debtor have a right in their debts. Otherwise, failing which, they lose their right for the purpose of claiming any debt post the period for notified by the liquidator in the Official Gazette. So that is where it is very important that such kind of notification is read and is definitely kept up to date by the liquidator in order to ensure that no lawful creditor loses his right to claim in respect of that particular in respect to that particular debtor. Lastly, I also come down to what happens to the particular case of bankruptcy. So once the once the assets have been taken over, they will definitely be sold by way of an auction, and the proceeds will be distributed in accordance with the claims which has been received. So in a nutshell, if I have to summarize the new law, the key takeaway is that this is an important law which will definitely give a relief to the various organizations which have suffered a lot during this COVID period. And therefore, in order to avoid any kind of a bankruptcy proceeding initiated against them, it is important for the businesses and obviously the industries to take a note of their rights under this particular law and come forth with the help of a bankruptcy expert to see and to analyze and assess if they are eligible to have a composite arrangement in order for them to continue with their business without being subject to a bankruptcy proceeding. Okay, so the last thing is, now if I have to summarize, the bankruptcy law aims to encourage investments in Oman. Why? Because like Mr. Makhija pointed out, it is important that any investor who is looking to invest in a particular segment or in a particular sector is able to realize his profits, or in case of any kind of a business failure, is able to realize or is able to enforce his rights under this particular law. Therefore, once implemented, this bankruptcy law will definitely provide a lot of assistance to these foreign experts. Thank you.
Mr. Pariyar ji, and I request anybody has any questions, please raise it in the question association so that we can have these questions being answered. So if no is there, then okay, one question came, sir. So let's answer this question. Is it not applicable to SEOG company? Mr. Jiten Singhvi has asked this question.
Yes. So to answer, it is applicable to SEOG companies, but if those SEOG companies are basically practicing the business of a banking company or an insurance company, in such case, it is not applicable.
Okay, sir. Mr. Krishna Prasad Rao has communicated our wishes to the very interesting and good speakers and topics. Great work by the MC teams. So thank you very much, Mr. Krishna Rao. And now I request, since there are no much questions, Mr. Aziz has started at Rotary Club. No, people will leave after the time is over. So let's try to conclude the session. And Mr. H.E. Mustafa Sultan, I request again to honor our next speaker, Mr. Vinit Parihar ji, with us on behalf of the chapter. With the
certificate.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah, Prabhu, I believe.
Okay, I have a question for Mr. Puneet Pariyar. Okay, now as per the liquidation of the company with the revised the appointments, now auditors in Oman are appointed as the liquidators of the company in Oman as per the new commercial company law in Oman, which is recently issued. Okay, my question to you is what is IBC and the liquidator? Now in the liquidators there is a minimum period of 3 years within, as Ashish Makhija said, it is time bound. Within 3 years you have to liquidate the company and then file the final liquidation report with the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Okay, yeah. Now with the IBC, what is that is it synchronizing the same thing with the receivers, appointment of the receivers and the liquidators? What is the roles and responsibilities? I appreciate if you enlighten on this.
Okay, the first thing is, like I said, I mean, the time period has been given to be 5 years here. Okay, now when it comes to the IBC or the bankruptcy expert, which has to be appointed here, the thing is that as of now, the rules are yet to be notified, right, for this particular thing. And the various eligibility requirements for these have to be formulated in order for us to better understand as to how these experts will be appointed and what are the criteria which will be followed.
Sir, one more question coming from the Mr. Krishna Prasad Rao.
Executive regulations are yet to come, Puneetji?
For the appointment of bankruptcy expert.
Okay, thank you.
Now you have one more question. Let me ask one question.
Yeah, yeah, please, sir.
Yeah. We have liquidation under the Companies Act.
Yes.
And the new regulation also.
Yes.
Both are active, I think, now. Can you, both routes a company can take now?
Sir, they can. They, definitely, they can take. But like I said, the idea for a bankruptcy law was to also include the other entities or kind of entities which are not covered under the commercial companies law. For example, like I said, a foreign the branch of a foreign company. Now, otherwise, it was not able to get any kind of a relief. But with the onset of a bankruptcy code, it can apply for a restructuring under the bankruptcy law.
Okay. Liquidation earlier, it was not covered under the Companies Act.
Yeah, because Companies Act only recognized the company. That's why.
Yeah. Branch was not covered.
Yes.
Thank you,
and how you can define between it is a bankruptcy or it is a fraud or who going to decide any, as an auditor who getting that books and find out it is a fraud or it is a normal bankruptcy?
It is actually a very good question, sir. See, that is where we have to realize that there have been very little instances of the implementation of this law for now. So it is when the court will look into the book of accounts. So when an application will be made by a debtor seeking protection under the bankruptcy, obviously its financial statements will be scrutinized by the court and the domain expert which has been appointed. So the onus will then fall from my experience on the bankruptcy expert to see if there has been any unscrupulous practice which has been carried out, or it was a hardship which has been faced by the debtor in the ordinary course of business. So that is where it is very important to have a domain level expert who should be appointed to understand and assess the book of accounts to determine the way in which or the circumstances which have led to the filing of the petition under the bankruptcy law.
Viniji, we'll have to very quick questions because of the sort of time. How many cases are reported in Oman compared to before COVID? Just one real short answer.
Okay, I don't know because this has not come out in the public domain. Okay.
Second question is, what is the order of the preference of the payment if the assets are not sufficient to settle all the claims?
The first will be the secured debtors, which will be followed by the unsecured and obvious, the governmental. So, first will be secured debtors, then the government, any fines and payments which have to be made to any government and administrative authority, and then it will move on in that hierarchy to be paid to the unsecured debtors and then the employees, etc.
In Oman, as you know, banks have the first charge on so many assets. Is this will be for the banks or for the liquidators or the creditors?
Sir, like I said, because if a bank is a secured creditor, it will have the first charge. But I will give you a practical example. Now, there is a company or client which we are advising upon. Now, surprisingly, in that particular case, the bank is an unsecured creditor. They had lended certain loans, but did not take any security against that. So in that case, their right to a claim on respect of a liquidated asset will not be first, but will be later on after the payment of all the dues, etc., to the financial and administrative authorities.
Thank you very much, Mr. Parpuniji. And now I request, I again request HE Mustafa Ahmed Salman to present a e-certificate to our next speaker as well. And we are really honored to be with you for the whole event. And we really appreciate your dedication to us. Sir, Mustafa, yeah.
Thanks, sir. Ravi.
Yeah, sir.
Thank you very much.
Yeah,
this is a certificate for great thanks for your lecture from the Oman chapter. Hope you accept this as a sort of support from the chapter to you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Puniji. And now I request, sir, there is one more question coming. Who will be the first secure bank or government dues? Can you just quickly take this question, sir?
It has to be the secure creditor in this particular case.
Okay, thank you, sir. So now I request CS Anil Varghese to...
Raviji.
Yeah.
I think Mr. Ashish Magija ji has a question.
Yes. Ashish ji, please hear the question, sir. Please, Ashish ji.
I don't have the question. I have just a very small comment. Two comments. Number one, as far as detecting the fraudulent transactions, Indian code says that it is the responsibility of the insolvency professional to detect those transactions. We call them as preferential transactions, undervalued, fraudulent, and extortionate. Second, as far as the order of priority is concerned in India, now this is very interesting. The government dues are now one step lower than the Companies Act. So first, obviously, as Mr. Bariar has mentioned, first is secured creditors along with workman dues for 24 months. Then comes the employee salary for 12 months. Then comes the unsecured financial creditors. And then comes the government dues. So government dues have been made one step lower in IBC. This was hugely different from the Companies Act. That is what I wanted to add.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
This is excellent step from India. In Oman government in the first, before anyone else, even before labor salary.
Yeah, because generally that concept is coming from UK where they're called as crown debts. So generally they were the top priority. Yeah.
Yeah, this is good and I will use it to tell all Oman authority.
Thank you very much.
Now I request yes, Anil Varghese to present a vote of thanks. Anil ji.
Yes. First of all, may I thank A.T. Mustafa Ahmed Salman to be present for our seminar today, as well as continuing till the end of the show. You know, thank you, sir, very much for being with us and for your active participation.
Thank you very much.
I would like to mention the participation by our Central Council members and the Committee for Insolvency and Bankruptcy Committee Chairman, C.A. Durgesh, as well as C.A. Prakash, to be with us today and to guide us through the sessions. You know, thank you, C.A. Durgesh, as well as C.A. Prakash, for your efforts on this morning. Next coming is C.A. Ashish. When Ravi put forward the suggestion to do this seminar, I asked a point, how useful it will be to the Oman Chartered Accountants. Now I understand very well, along with our members, how useful it has been. Thank you, C.A. Ashish, for your enlightening talks and how it will be useful for all the Chartered Accountants to be having in the back of their mind of starting this profession back in India, as well as other places too. Thank you, Ashish, for your very, very fruitful talk. As well as regarding Oman, Mr. Puneet, you have been wonderful and a very, very enlightening talk. And things are rolling out here and the executive regulations are on the way. We hope to have your involvement as well as C.A. Ashish, we will look forward to your involvement as well as the local involvement from the professional like Mr. Puneet in the coming days as we progress with this profession. Okay. All the same, I wish that the number of companies going into this process reduce, even though we want more work. It is going in that direction is actually a bad sign for the economy. Hopefully, it
we strike an equilibrium in this regard. I hope we do that. And last but not the least, the CBFS for their support, as well as the members in large. And I have seen the number of participation of around 90 participations were at the end of the session too. As Mr. Ashish said, nobody decided to leave. Thank you, members, for being with us till the last moment. Thank you, everybody, for the presence. Thanks.
Saniji, we need to present our thought process on the World Congress again to the members. The World Congress 2022 will be held in 2022 November, and we request each and every member from Muscat chapter to support this this event, and we will be very heartfully supporting this, and we seek everybody's support to us. Thank you, sir. That's it.
Yes,
thank you.
Raviji, can we have a group photo, please?
I think Jim, only you will take it again. Sir, whoever is in the video, please switch on your video, sir. Who are in the speakers, please switch on the video.
Yashpal ji,
Aswini ji. See, Aswini ji. Yeah.
Mubinji is there?
Mubinji has a toothache, so he left.
Last word from Mubinji, our regulator.
Mubinji is not there, I think.
Okay, take
Yashpal ji, Yashpal ji, you would like to say some few words, sir, before we conclude?
It's not to be seen.
Yashpal ji, you would like to say something? Yes. Aswini ji, you would like to say something, sir, to conclude then.
I think this is a very pertinent topic, so I'm very glad that these dignitaries have come today and addressed this topic, and it is very evident from the attendance of our members. So thank you so much for coming and addressing our members on this very, very pertinent topic to all the dignitaries. Thank you so much.
Thank you. That's it.
Thank you, Ashwin ji.
Yes, Jim Saab, take a photo.
Done. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Your Excellency, and look forward to your continued support. Thank you, Ashish ji. Yeah. Thank you, Puneet Pariyar ji, and thank you all my managing committee team to put this very interactive and very important topic for today's webinar. Thank you very much. Signing off.
Yashpal ji is here. Yashpal ji, you would like to say some few words, sir, last words from your side?
No, thank you so very much. It was indeed enjoyable, and I was particularly happy to see our friend Mustafa. So it was great to see him on the Zoom. It has been a while, and I am actually missing Muscat a lot. Unfortunately, couldn't come. I had planned to be there, but the COVID situation doesn't seem to be going. Professionally, I think I learned a lot from both the speakers, and I am tempted to become a member or a practicing solvency expert, as one of the speakers said. So I will get in touch with him and probably see him how to get a hole-in-one in golf. So thank you all so very much. And it was a pleasure.
I have noted down your mobile number, sir. I'll definitely get in touch with you.
Yeah, thank you.
I'll be in touch with you for the classes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. Anytime, sir. Anytime.
Thank you.
Ashish ji, we will also with our sponsors, College and Banking and Financial Studies, and with the permission of His Excellency, for the Chamber of Commerce also, we will have some joint events on IBC going forward, okay, together with the Muscat chapter.
Yeah, of course.
Anytime. Most welcome.
Thank you, sir. I conclude this meeting, sir, with the permission of the Chairman and Chief. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everybody.